the late 1700s, after the American War of Independence, there was a tremendous movement of people into the maritime provinces, southern New Brunswick and Nova Scotia in particular. These United Empire loyalists, those who wished to remain loyal to the British Crown rather than join the newly formed United States of America, brought with them their bridge-building technology, their Howe Truss, their Town Truss, the Burr Truss, and also the habit of covering the bridges. An uncovered bridge, a wooden span, had a life of about 15 years, but covered it was good for 80 years. In its heyday, New Brunswick probably had 350 to 400 covered bridges, but today we're down to fewer than 70. This video will capture some of the charm of a past culture. Take us back to a day in New Brunswick when life was a little less hectic than perhaps today, a slower pace. It'll take us back to a day when horsepower still had four legs and wood was the building material of choice. It's a complete collection of all the standing covered bridges in our province, plus some archival material of bridges that we have lost. New Brunswick's covered bridges are now in their senior years. In fact, several of them have been retired. They're no longer available for moving traffic, but they are there for those who love them and for the tourists who come to see them. Soon all our bridges will be a curiosity of history, like the magnificent tall ships, the horse and buggy, or the drive-in theater. Join us on our tour. We'll travel from Gillis, Maine, St. Stephen, New Brunswick, along the southern part of the province to Nova Scotia, and then up the Trans-Canada Highway along the St. John River to the province of Quebec. Get a glimpse of the last of the covered bridges of the picture province. Our covered bridge journey begins in Charlotte County in the border town of St. Stephen. This is one of the busiest border crossings in New Brunswick. Many years ago, an international covered bridge connected Gillis, Maine to St. Stephen. That bridge and many others in Charlotte County are now long gone. Seven bridges remain, nestled along the back roads of the county. Bridge in Charlotte County, and a little further down the guardrail, Gene and Tina are announcing their love in the year 1996, and lo and behold, a little further up in the guardrail, we see Gene and Tina to be married June the 13th, 1997. So Gene and Tina, we wish you all the very best, and maybe in a few years from now, we'll be seeing some birth announcements on our guardrail as well. Congratulations. St. John County is noted for its rugged and rocky coastline. Here, the Bay of Fundy begins to display the highest tides in the world. The county is dotted with lighthouses and fishing villages and three of the prettiest covered bridges you'll find anywhere. picturesque village of St. Martin's on the Fundy coast is the last place in the province where you can photograph two bridges at the same time. The village is increasingly becoming a tourist destination, as is at the start of the new Fundy Trail. The quaint beauty of the fishing village is enhanced with a stately pair of old bridges. Kings County is the covered bridge capital of New Brunswick, with more standing bridges than anywhere else in the province. Here's a classic problem with the old bridges. They really are like a house of cards. And once you start knocking down one card, the whole thing's gonna fall in. This beam's been nicked by a truck going by. It's been knocked out of position. And the whole thing is really very, very fragile. When these beams are originally put together, see this one down here? They're like Chinese fingers, the children's game. And the more stress you put on the bridge, the stronger the joint actually becomes. But as soon as it's knocked out of alignment, then it's very, very fragile. We've had cases in the province of New Brunswick where a piece of heavy equipment would nick one of the main supporting beams and the whole bridge would just literally fall right down on top of the piece of equipment. To increase the strength of the covered bridge, bridge builders use what's called an upset end rod. The very ends of these steel poles are swollen so that when the threads were cut into them, they didn't decrease the diameter of the rod itself and kept them very, very strong. A good covered bridge can be tuned like a violin or a guitar. The bridges should be slightly higher in the middle than at the ends. They should have an arch. And the engineers will come along with a large set of wrenches, and at the end of each of these rods is a bolt, and they can literally adjust the way that the bridge sets. If it's higher in the middle and a heavy vehicle comes into the bridge, instead of sagging in the middle, it becomes level and becomes very, very strong. And these joints that we talked about tighten up, and the bridge is at its strongest point when it's under stress. Back in the early days, the covered bridges were used for public announcement bulletin boards. Politicians would post their information on the bridge. Everybody in the community at one time or another had to go through the covered bridge, so it was a great spot to put anything that you wanted everybody in the community to see. And here's the reputation the bridges have for being the kissing bridges. We've got a love affair going on here between BW and MB. Good luck, folks.
Beautiful. Water's clear and clean. No pollution. Nice and warm, flowing good. And the bridge acts as a nice shade when you're hot.
Big fat man.
Good clean water. It's not really deep. The kids can enjoy themselves and they can relax on the beach. And just enjoy it. Plus, we're from the area and it's nice just to come and see friends and enjoy yourself. Most days you come here, you know, most everybody comes here, so we talk, gossip, whatever there is to do.
The old-time bridge engineers were quite a frugal lot, and they expected the foreman of the bridge crew to account for every nail, every screw, every linear board foot of lumber that went into the bridge. So when it came time to cross the river, they'd build the bridge square to the river, and the roads would run parallel to the river, and when it came time to cross on the bridge, 90-degree turn, and we see this beautifully here at the Smithtown Bridge, through the bridge and another 90-degree turn at the other end, and on she goes, the road follows the river on up. Smithtown was built in 1912. It's still in beautiful shape. There's been a lot of repair work going on. We see some fairly fresh lumber here that's pressure treated and so on. So I think the Smithtown's got a great future. It's got a thriving community around it, and you can see from the people down below having to swim, it's very much a part of their community. They have bonfires down there. They'll have barbecues down there. They'll have weddings down there. So it's a great spot. Back in the 60s, there was a group of concerned citizens in the province of Brunswick who banded together, and they called themselves the League for Rural Renewal. They and their families took it upon themselves to clean up the areas around the covered bridges. A lot of the Kings County bridges received attention from this group. They'd come in, clean up the approachways, put up some picnic tables. In a couple of cases, they put up some white picket fences, and they made the bridges a very, very attractive sight to be. Lots of people would come out on a Sunday afternoon and have a picnic by the old covered bridges. This bridge received some attention from the League for Rural Renewal. The late James Nels, who lives across the river in Bloomfield, adopted this bridge. The siding on the bridge was in pretty bad shape, and the Department of Transportation wanted to put some new boards on the bridge. Nels would have nothing to do with that. He insisted that they go and tear down a few derelict barns and use those grade weathered boards to finish off the bridge so that it looked as stately and as royal as it possibly could. This bridge has just had a new roof put on it in the last 2 years. It's fortunate. It's very close to Route 1 from St. John to Moncton. A lot of tourists go by here, stop and admire the bridge. It's a high-profile bridge, and it's going to have a good future. A lot of our bridges are in very remote areas. There's not a lot of traffic going by, and vandals tend to pick on them, and they seem to be the ones that we're losing very, very rapidly. But bridges like the Moosehorn, I think we're going to see around for a long time yet. Almost all of New Brunswick's bridges, you'll find these triangular blocks. They were designed so that the main cords did not have to be cut at an angle at the ends, and it ensured more strength. Sometimes you'll find them made of metal. These are made of wood. Most of New Brunswick's bridges are the Howe Truss design. We do have two or three in the province that are of a slightly different style of engineering, but this is the most common by all means. New Brunswick bridges tend to be fairly plain. When you go down to New England, you'll find that they are painted and very, very elaborate designs and so on, but ours were simple. Simple, and they lasted a long time. Darling's Island covered bridge was about to be replaced with a modern concrete crossing. The community of Darling's Island fought to preserve their old friend. Their efforts were recognized, and the provincial government built a new bridge a few meters upstream. One of the advocates for the preservation of the Darling's Island covered bridge was Peter LeBlanc.
And the covered bridge has always been a source of tranquility for many of us. We always feel when we come home at night and drive through the bridge, we sort of enter a different realm and away from the hubbub and the rush of the city. Now I think it's there, we all know it's still there, but most of us don't use it at all because we of course use the new structure. So But certainly, it's a landmark of the island, and I think many, many people would hope it stays here.
One of the last covered bridges that I know of around. There used to be another one at the other end of Milkish Creek when I was little, but it's long gone. There's a causeway there now. I would hate to see it go. I really enjoy it. When I was a teenager, there used to be what we called a bridge club. We didn't play bridge. It was a place to gather because there wasn't any corner store and there wasn't any community hall or anything in those days. It was where everybody met everybody else. I'll meet you at the bridge. They've put tar over the boards in the bridge. The planks are laid on edge so that they will wear longer. This is where the children jump out of the bridge. It's sort of a rite of passage for the young fellows in the neighborhood, you know. When they're 13 or 14, to prove how grown up and brave they are, they dive from the bridge into the water underneath.
Highway 890 in Kings County, there's a store with a great focus. It's the Kissing Bridge Gift Shop, run by Bob Alston. Bob and his wife Sandra have gathered an amazing collection of covered bridge paraphernalia. There are serving trays to letterheads, Christmas ornaments to stained glass. Bob and Sandra have had visitors from all over the world. You can even find them on the World Wide Web. Oldfield Covered Bridge gained national recognition when it was featured on a Canadian quarter. It was chosen as a symbol of the province of New Brunswick for this collection of 1992 coins. A granite monument at the entrance to the old bridge commemorates this event.
Plum Sweet Bridge, it's been there 1910, it was built, and the wooden pilings were drove with the horses, pulled the sledge up and dropped it and drove the pillars, I know that for sure. The chap that lives here, Johnny Hines, he's, when he was young in his teens, he had the contract for snow on the bridge, when they used to have to put the snow into cover the bridge inside so that the sledges and the drags could go through it. Oh, about 7-8 years ago, the young lads down the road here decided they were going to pull a Halloween prank, and they climbed up inside the bridge and they hung a 2x4 off a rope, and they figured they just had it the right height that it just hit the top of the car going through. And of course, by luck, the first car went through with his father, and he took the windshield out on him. So it wasn't too good a Halloween for them young fellas. I think the government should take the responsibility and keep them a little better care of them. This one here, Plum Sweet, swimming season, the kids kick the boards off to swim. And then when they get them back on, come salmon season, they're all kicked off again so they can see the salmon in the, under the bridge. Which they pool under the bridge, you can see them where they knock the boards out. But the government is slowly realizing they've got to maintain them. When you look at them, your mind just goes back in years. They're well, out of this world. When I was courting with the wife, that's where we used to head, the cover bridge up her way, and we used to always stop under there and have a kiss or two before we made it to the house. So. The truckers hate them, naturally, the loggers, because of the weight restriction and the height restriction.
The Department of Transportation frequently places iron barriers before and after the bridges. The concept is simple. If you don't rip the top off your rig on the barrier, you'll probably be able to get through the bridge.
But as far as the scenery, they fit right in there. Oh, people come from all over. We have people come down the road here, come from Rhode Island, Florida, everywhere to come take pictures here. And belonging to the Cover Bridge Society, they always stopped in. So we get quite a bunch.
In, I think it was October 1996, a sad event took place where a truck that was loaded with gravel, an overloaded truck, passed through this bridge from this direction to that direction. And about 10 seconds after the truck went through the bridge collapsed.
The old Bell Bridge has been temporarily replaced with a Bailey Bridge. The community hopes that the province will eventually rebuild it with another covered bridge.
I guess the when I heard about it and then when I came here, it was much like going to a funeral. I have never seen so many people visit a bridge that had died. And from what I understand, this seems to be the thing that takes place. All of these people had a piece of the bridge in their life.
When the Bell Bridge went down, that I managed to salvage quite a bit of the timber to use for carving, which I hope to do some carvings out of later on, which is out of this world hard, I can tell you, and sound. This is out of the old bridge. This is the sleepers that went under, you know, under the floor, and then there was planked in, and then another smaller sleepers then planked again, and then the gravel mat, if it was done through, was put on top of that. But that's what that is, that's one of the sleepers. And on the Howe Trust, that there's one of them there, riders under that. I don't know what that there, that different kind again that looks, it must have been replaced.
Queens County, too, has suffered a recent loss of a covered bridge. This is where the old Bayard Bridge used to stand. The valley was a lot different on the morning of March the 10th, 1998. Jill and Sarah Carson captured the last few moments of the Bayard Bridge on home video.
Okay, we had heavy rains all night, and we didn't really realize that there would be a flood like this. And we happened to get up in the morning and look out, and we saw behind our house here, it was flooded and up to the banks. So obviously we first thought of down around the bridge because we knew earlier, in earlier years, it had flooded. So we decided that we'd get in the van and go for a drive to see what we were going to see, and we were stunned when we went down and saw how high the water had came so quickly overnight, and that the bridge had already started to go sideways. As a child, we always saw the bridge there and enjoyed it, but as we got older and became a teenager, we spent lots of time, all the kids in Wall Street spent lots of time down there. We would go and sit in the bridge and tell stories and talk, and quite often we'd take our bikes through and go down to Gilligan's and go swimming, which was just down to the left across the field, and we'd spend most of our summer down through there. I find the valley is still very beautiful, but it doesn't seem the same. It doesn't have the heritage now that it used to have. And a lot of people that we see, they notice it. If they're not from Wallsford, they notice it right away, and they always mention it, that they miss the bridge, that it's gone. And it's gone for good.
We're in Upper Queens County on the Burpee Bridge, and the community bulletin board is in full swing here. Let's take a look at some of the local news here. We've got Chris of 98 and Ken B of the class of 97. Josh Sloan is here of the grad class of 98. Let's see, grads of 97, Stephanie Carmier. We've got Julie loves Drew, and Drew's names cross out, and Peter's in there, so Julie must be in the middle of a relationship change here. Connie is going up the sideway. Great Natalie and Ryan Marcus. Great Natalie. Greg Natalie? Great Natalie? Who said the class of 98 couldn't spell? Look at this. From Queens County, we continue up the St. John River Valley into Sunbury County, home of four covered bridges.
We need them because it's our history. People relied on bridges like these, for they were hauling milk and lumber, you know, and the only way to get across these streams in high water. And it's been here. It's like your home. You know, you utilize it all the time. You know, it's a beautiful thing. We all love it. Provincial government could save not everyone, but the vast majority of them. You know, it's for our kids. It's for the future, you know. Future doesn't have to be steel structures 20 stories high. It doesn't have to be subways. It doesn't have to be modern bus services. this is just a small bit of New Brunswick, and it doesn't take that much to save a little bit of New Brunswick for, you know, for our children and our children's children.
In York County, you will find New Brunswick's capital city of Fredericton and three covered bridges. This old bridge is in a remote location, and its future may not be as secure as those bridges in populated areas. Vandals look for opportunities like this. Boards are kicked off and carted away or burned. Without somebody to look after the old bridge, it may not be around for very long. Trans-Canada Highway continues into Carleton County, home of the longest covered bridge in the world. At 1,282 feet, it crosses the St. John River at Heartland. John Glass is a local historian and co-author of a book entitled The Bridge, the story of Heartland's famous landmark.
Well, the people on both sides of the river were demanding that the government build a bridge, and the government just didn't have the money. So they decided eventually to form a private company, and the private company built the bridge. It was then for 6 years they charged tolls, and then about 20 years later, the two western spans of the bridge went out with the ice, and at that point they covered it. So it wasn't covered at first, but it was covered in 1921. But then there was a lot of controversy around the covering of the bridge. Some people were very concerned about what effect it would have on the morals of the young people to have a covered bridge right in the center of town. And we even had sermons, I understand, that were preached on the fact of what a covered bridge would do to the morals of the young people. The covered bridge, and I guess all covered bridges, are both kissing bridges and wishing bridges. And if you make a wish when you enter the bridge, and of course this can't be the driver, but a person will make their wish, cross their fingers, close their eyes, and hold their breath. And if you're able to do that clear across the bridge, your wish is very likely to come true. And of course, the kissing bridge, it's just an area where you're supposed to steal a kiss from your spouse or partner.
Walked across the bridge with my boyfriend, stood in the middle of it, and laid a big one on him. And I was the initiator. Couldn't wait to grow up so I could actually stand on the bridge and kiss. I remember when I moved from St. John, I was 8 years old, September the 4th. When you come from a city and move to here, it's quite a shock. I remember coming through the bridge and my father telling me to hold my breath and make a wish, because if I made a wish, it would come true. So I made a wish that Heartland was a good place and I could feel as comfortable in Heartland as I did in St. John. And it took a couple of years, but guess what? My wish come true. And I remember the enthusiasm and my heart pumping as I drove through this bridge that was covered, and it was so awesome. And when you come out the other end, you came to this quaint little quiet community. And I can remember feeling so overwhelmed. It was just, I remember the next day coming down and just standing on the bridge. And as a little girl, it just seemed like such a huge thing. And I've been very proud of it ever since.
A Washington paper, I think it was back in about 1960. They had a contest about famous tourist spots in the world, and one lady wrote in to identify the covered bridge, and in her story about it, she said that it was like visiting an old relative. When you came and you almost could feel as if somebody from your past was there. And I think our a lot of our ancestors worked on the bridge, and certainly a lot of them fought and worked hard in order to get it here. And we're very proud of it.
I mean, look at it. Look what people did. I mean, they built this 100 years ago. I mean, think about 100 years ago, you know, the technology then as opposed to now. And to build this bridge across here and to connect Somerville with Heartland, I mean, the thrill of the connection was just unbelievable. You know, you talk to some of the 80-year-old men in town who remember their fathers telling them about the thrill of the connection. It was just like the biggest day ever. It was just the biggest day ever. So to me, when I look at that bridge, it's Heartland. It's what we are.
Bridge was built, I think, in 1884, the original bridge, and the ice took it out in 1895, the next spring. Well, it was built back again in 1896. It was just taken for granted, I guess, that it was always going to be the span on the other end of the bridge, but there was a house down along the riverside that got on fire. One day it was about noontime in 1932. It was in the summer, I think it was in July or August, and the sparks from the fire went and struck the roof of the bridge, because it was covered with cedar shingles. It caught fire. Well, we had no fire department, and so the span on the other end of the bridge burned. And it got into the asphalt, and it was burning across the bridge, and they knew it would come to this side. So they dug up a space. They wondered how to stop it, and that's how they got it stopped. They dug up a space in the floor, about three or four feet in the floor, and the fire burned itself out and fell into the river. Back when I was a very small girl, too small to know, and there was a man found in the bridge dead. And there was another man in the village who left very, very fast. The night before, there'd been a big poker game. This man that was dead had won the pot, and had won quite a lot of money. This man that disappeared, he had lost a lot of money. When they found his body, there was no money in his pockets. And they always figured that. Then nobody could prove it. I don't think they ever even tried to. They just took it for granted that a bunch of them had been playing poker and he'd been dead. He was killed or something. But that would be the murder. And that took place on the bridge.
To the north in Carleton County near Johnville lies the Keenan Bridge. This kissing bridge has a darker side. Ann Brennan is a heritage artist living near the bridge.
The Keenan Bridge was built in 1927, replacing an older bridge that was built earlier on by the early settlers who came to the area. When they built the new bridge, they sort of changed the road, straightened it out, so that it would meet the new bridge at this particular point where we stand now. When they were digging the post holes for this bridge, they uncovered a human skull, which led to great speculation. There were no other bones except the skull. And the local men asked the road supervisor at that time what they should do with it. And he suggested that they take it over away from the river and bury it. And he just said to bury it deep. So then from that point on, we sort of went from story to story until we ended up with a covered bridge that's much used, much loved, and much revered by the local people, but also carried with it a tremendous ghost story. And the pattern of the ghost spirit seems to be that it's a woman figure and that she usually joins people driving through the bridge. In the olden days, of course, it would have been by horse and carriage or horse and wagon in the country area. And she would get on at one end of the bridge and drive to the other end of the bridge. And I would say a number of people have had this particular experience of being accompanied through the bridge, but she always leaves them at the other end of the bridge. Yeah. Oh, I have no fear in the world of the bridge. I'm not afraid of ghosts.
Francis Cullen lives at one end of the Keenan Bridge.
I do feel there was something in the bridge because there was too many people had experiences there. There had to be something. They weren't all liars. There was one man, especially many years ago, his sister was married and lived up next door to me. He had a horse and sleigh, and he was going up this road to visit his sister on Sunday afternoon, and when he came through the bridge, no one but himself, and when he got through the bridge on this side, there was a lady all dressed in black sitting in with him, and she sat with him, and the horse was terrified, and it more or less ran away and raced up, and she apparently disappeared down here around our gate on the road. And he went on up, and the horse turned the horse into his sister, and he fainted and fell in the door. Now that's the story, true or false.
Continuing north, we travel through Victoria and Madawaska counties to the boundary of Quebec.
On a shiny day, and the time it took was the time of day when the sun it slowly fades away. Life is nothing but bridges. Daylight needs a seed to grow. Streams increase as the rivers flow. Time is testing. Just fixing broken bridges. Take me back to the other shore. I've seen this one a time before. I'm not stranded on this bridge. One more step and I'm over the edge.
Northumberland is a large county taking in the headwaters of the mighty Marmoshee. There used to be many bridges crossing the rivers and the streams of Northumberland. Only one covered bridge remains, the oldest one in the province, Nelson Hollow. Nelson Hollow is one of two bridges still standing in the province featuring a hip roof. Kent County, home to much of the province's Acadian population, boasts the warmest saltwater beaches north of Virginia, and some beautiful old covered bridges.
Thank you. they're drilling test holes to put a new bridge up parallel to the mouth bridge, and probably will start work on that next summer. But when you go to the other side of the bridge, a great deal of work has been put there. There's a new wall on the side of the bridge, and there's lots of new window ports, and it's quite obvious that the province is going to keep the St. Nicholas here, if nothing else, as a tourist attraction. So there's a tip of hat to the province of New Brunswick for trying to preserve the old St. Nicholas.
Westmoreland County winds through the Tantramar Marshes to the border of Nova Scotia. Sometimes folks will take refuge from a storm in the covered bridges, but it's not probably always the best thing to do. You can hear the wind in this bridge. We're at the Wheaton in Westmoreland County, and if anything, the wind's blowing harder inside the bridge than it is outside. It's like a natural wind tunnel. And it really can howl in here. We're in Moncton, Westmoreland County, and this is the Magnetic Hill Covered Bridge. Originally built around 1912, it was down in Parkindale. The bridge was disassembled and moved up here and reassembled in Moncton as part of this private enterprise of Magnetic Hill Park. It's quite a tourist attraction. We've been here a couple of minutes and we've watched cars coming through from Alberta, Manitoba, Pennsylvania, so it's quite a landmark for the Moncton area. Albert County is ruggedly beautiful and home to the only national park in Canada with covered bridges. This is also where you'll find one of New Brunswick's most ardent defenders of covered bridges, Mary Micah.
Well, this was the first of my bridges that I was able to save. That one was already in danger because they have been taking down all the covered bridges along the Highway 114, which leads from Fundy National Park to Moncton. And I thought that at least this one, that only one that is still left, should be preserved, if not for nothing else, for the fact that tourists and also local people enjoy it. And you can see right here in the background, there are people picnicking right now, and there are tremendous numbers of tourists who are stopping here, taking pictures, and kissing in the bridge. For many people, this is the only covered bridge that they might encounter.
This is Crooked Creek number 3 in Albert County. She's called number 3 because it's the third bridge to cross Crooked Creek from its mouth. The bridge was put up in 1945. You can see from the surroundings, she's in a very, very rural setting. And obviously the people in the community have a lot of respect for the bridge because it's still standing. It's a long trek in here from the main highway over some pretty rough roads. So you want to be in here to see this bridge before you're going to make that much of an effort to come in. The small fishing village of Alma is the gateway to Fundy National Park and its two covered bridges. In 1992, Point Wolf Cover Bridge was destroyed when a construction crew blasted overhanging rock. A large boulder struck the bridge, causing it to collapse into the riverbed below. Parks Canada was convinced to reconstruct the bridge. Rob Walker, an employee of Parks Canada, oversaw the reconstruction.
So this is a Hautrous covered bridge built with 1990s technology. And I'm quite certain that this bridge is going to endure for a long time. It's probably the last one that will ever be built in New Brunswick, if not in North America, on a public road. And who knows how long it's going to last? Well into the 21st century, we hope.
This is William Mitten Bridge, Albert County. Although it's off the beaten path and it's no longer in use, the bridge is in very, very good shape. It's being well taken care of by the community. The approaches to the bridge show some fresh lumber, and there aren't any boards missing. It's in very, very good shape. It's another Burr Truss. There's only a few of them left in the province. This is Bamford Copet Covered Bridge in Albert County, and it's probably one of the most picturesque bridges in the province of New Brunswick. Beautiful setting. It's a unique bridge in a number of ways. It's a Burr Truss as compared to a Howe Truss, which most of the province's bridges are. And the Burr Truss is distinguished by long, strong carrying beams going up diagonal to the surface of the bridge. There are very few of the big, heavy, upset rod iron posts that we saw in other bridges. They're quite fine in this bridge. It looks like a lot of the original equipment here. The floor looks like the original flooring. It hasn't changed much since the bridge was built. One of the nicest things I think about this bridge is the old advertisements here on the side. McLeod's Fine Clothing, the latest in fashions, and somebody over here is advertising for eyeglasses, and at the far end of the bridge is an advertisement for sleighs and ropes. This would have been the vintage advertising that was on it when it was built back in the 20s or 30s. At one time, New Brunswick had hundreds of bridges. Most are gone, but a few survive in old photographs. Here are some we discovered which show old New Brunswick as our grandparents knew it.
The covered bridges under Brunswick were built to stand for many years, some have. It's our hope that remaining bridges will be preserved and protected for future generations, so many more can experience the magic of our kissing bridges.